Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the cytoskeleton in human cells, and in part 2, I'll be talking about microfilaments and intermediate filaments. Just a quick recap of part 1. The cytoskeleton is a framework of protein filaments inside the cell, which is needed for a lot of functions, including the most obvious one, which would be providing structure and support to the cell. There are three important groups: microtubules, intermediate filaments, and microfilaments. In part 1, I went over microtubules, and I find a good way to learn about microfilaments is to compare them to microtubules. So what do we need to know about microtubules? They are heterodimers with alpha and beta tubulins. They are polarized with a plus end and a minus end. They are dynamically unstable, so they can assemble and disassemble by polymerizing and depolymerizing, which happens more at the plus end than at the minus end. This process involves GTP. They form a part of cilia and flagella. They help with the transport of organelles inside the cell by using molecular motor proteins like kinesin and dynein. They also form the spindle fibers during cell division. Now, microfilaments have the smallest diameter of the three groups, around 5 nanometers. They're also called thin filaments, and they are made up of actin. Does actin sound familiar? That's because we study it along with myosin during muscle contraction. These microfilaments are actin filaments. They start with monomer subunits called globular actin or G-actin. These are bound to ATP rather than GTP in microtubules. These actin monomers polymerize, so they join together to form a filament, ultimately forming F-actin, which includes two filaments that wind around each other. Like microtubules, these two are polarized. They have a plus end and a minus end. New units get added mostly to the plus end when bound to ATP. The ATP gets hydrolyzed to ADP, and then those units disengage from the minus end, so they can lengthen and shorten. But if both addition and removal happen at the same rate, the length stays the same, but this assembly and disassembly helps the filaments move. Actin filaments are associated with myosin. Myosin is a molecular motor protein. In skeletal muscles, that's mostly myosin type 2. Myosin molecules have a head and a tail with a hinge in between, where it can bend when ATP gets hydrolyzed. So it does hydrolyze ATP. Two myosin molecules wind together and they stack up in anti-parallel directions, ultimately forming a thick filament. Because of the anti-parallel arrangement, the center is bare, having just the tails of the myosin molecules, with the heads angled out towards the sides. These thick and thin filaments, they work together. The energy from myosin hydrolyzing ATP that bends the hinge, which can pull the actin thin filaments inwards. That's how sarcomeres in muscles shorten, contracting the muscle. So microfilaments are obviously important for muscle contraction. Cells like macrophages, they migrate to the sites of inflammation, and they do so with the help of these actin and myosin filaments, so it helps with pseudopod formation and cell locomotion. Remember how microtubules form the spindle fibers during cell division? They help separate the chromatids. But the last step of mitosis, when the cytoplasm divides, that is by microfilaments. They contract and form a cleavage furrow, ultimately splitting the cell into daughter cells. So microfilaments are needed for cytokinesis. Microtubules form cilia and flagella, but villi have microfilaments. Villi are those finger-like projections on the apical surface of epithelial cells in some parts of the body. What do villi do? They increase surface area. So they would be useful in areas where there's lots of absorption happening, like in the small intestine and the proximal convoluted tubule of the kidney. So microfilaments are more towards the cortex of the cells, and they provide strength and support to the cell. Actin is also associated with tight junctions between cells. And those are some of the different functions that microfilaments have. But remember that thin filaments are microfilaments because they've got actin. Thick filaments are myosin. Now let's move on to intermediate filaments. Intermediate filaments are called intermediate because their diameter is between that of thin and thick filaments, They're around 8 to 10 nanometers. They are again formed from monomers. Monomers form dimers, which then arrange in anti-parallel directions to form tetramers. They stack up end-to-end, side-to-side. Ultimately, they're going to form a rope-like intermediate filament. Now, unlike the other two groups, they are not polar. They are not dynamically unstable either. They radiate through the cytoplasm, forming a scaffolding. They are important for structural support. There are actually different types of intermediate filaments in different cells. It depends on the type of cell or sometimes on the structure inside the cell. Like in muscle, desmin is an intermediate filament. In fibroblasts, vimentin. In neurons, neurofilaments support the structure of the axon. In the nucleus, nuclear lamins maintain the structure and shape of the nucleus and its envelope. Epithelial cells have keratin. That's probably the easiest one to remember. Keratin filaments give strength to the skin, hair, and nails. Together with desmosomes and hemidesmosomes, keratin intermediate filaments, they help with cell-to-cell adhesion and cell-to-matrix adhesion. I'll probably be able to explain this better when I talk about the structure of the skin. But that was all about microfilaments and intermediate filaments, and together with microtubules, they all form the cell cytoskeleton. I hope this video was useful. If it helped you, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.